In this lesson, we'll once again demonstrate how to start from a simple Pi system to an architecture that's a lot more complex. Along the way, we'll review the components of the Pi system that were shown in earlier videos, as well as be introduced to newer Pi system pieces that give users more power and capabilities. So far, we've seen the flow of data from data source to end user. And although this is complete in itself, we've mainly seen diagrams that show just the minimal amount of components required, namely data source, Pi interface, Pi data archive, and end user. But as we'll soon see, there's a lot more paths for our data to flow through, like from one company to another, and also through custom applications built on top of the Pi system. So we'll start here. The Pi data archive and the Pi AF server are both on the same machine. Assuming that the number of Pi points is expected to increase, let's place the Pi data archive separate on its own computer. Let's also assume that the data in the Pi data archive is vital and must be made highly available for users in the organization. This calls for a Pi collective, consisting of multiple Pi data archives. This highly available design allows for independent storages of the same time series data. Let's turn our focus briefly to the end users. They utilize Pi client applications to retrieve and view data. Remember, these include Pi Core Site, Pi Process Book, and Pi Data Link. All of these Pi client tools are built on a Pi system platform called Pi SDK. When a Pi client application connects to the Pi collective, Pi SDK recognizes this and retrieves a list of all the members in the Pi collective. When an issue arises between a Pi client tool and its connected Pi collective member, Pi SDK automatically switches over to a different available member. Now, let's take a step back and discuss how Pi collective members contain identical sets of the same time series data. This wouldn't be possible without the Pi interface node, so let's bring it into the picture. Along with the one or more Pi interfaces running on this machine, there's another Pi system component called the Pi buffer subsystem that must also be running. Specifically, the Pi buffer subsystem has a feature called end-way buffering that creates and sends copies of time series data. Let's say this machine is running just one interface, namely the Pi interface for OPCDA. We'll configure the Pi buffer subsystem on the same machine as well. Here is a data value, timestamp, and a value produced by the data source. The Pi interface then retrieves this value. As it leaves the Pi interface, the data value is picked up by the Pi buffer subsystem and then duplicated for each member of the Pi collective. Finally, each replicate is sent along its way. As you can see, the Pi buffer subsystem via end-way buffering is the key component in creating identical sets of time series data for every member of the Pi collective. Another point to make with buffering is in the name itself. In the scenario that one of the Pi data archives goes offline, interface buffering will begin to buffer data, or hold on to it temporarily, while it waits for the Pi data archive to become available again. When it is available, it'll flush all the held data to the now available Pi data archive. So here is our architecture diagram again. At this point, let's also incorporate interface failover into our architecture. Remember, this is similar to a Pi collective in that multiple instances are configured. So if one Pi interface goes down, there's another instance that can pick right back up. Note that for Pi interface failover, a maximum of two instances can be configured for this. Also, while many common and newer Pi interfaces support interface failover, there are still some that do not. The user manuals for a Pi interface will explicitly state if it supports interface failover. Now, moving on to different components, we've seen the Pi to Pi interface before. In this previous example, we had a Pi collective separated by that firewall. This was to prevent users from being granted access to the DMZ, and rather use a Pi data archive on their own network. The Pi to Pi interface can also be used to send data between just two standalone Pi data archives, or even two collective. So let's say a Pi data archive exists at some remote site far away. If the corporate headquarters wants access to the data, a Pi to Pi interface can be set up to automatically transfer data from the Pi data archive at the remote site to the Pi collective at headquarters. This prevents the need to grant users at headquarters special access to the Pi data archive at the remote site. Next, let's say there are two entirely different companies that need to exchange Pi data. One can be a vendor who sells pumps, and another is the vendor's customer. The vendor provides services to help maintain its pumps that it sells. Rather than having to wait for the customer to report any faulty issues with the pumps, the vendor could be more proactive if it had real-time data access to the pump's performances. Here, Pi Cloud Connect can step right in and make this possible. It allows for easy and secure exchange of Pi system data between companies. The Pi to Pi interface might sound like it could do the trick, but the subtle difference is that a VPN of some sort would be required, since the Pi to Pi interface is designed to be within a single network or two that are connected securely. Pi Cloud Connect uses secure pathways via the cloud or internet to facilitate this data exchange so that no VPN is necessary. Another way to use Pi system data is with Pi system access. This is a suite of products designed to support the implementation of custom applications on top of the Pi system. Think of this as libraries to help bring data out of the Pi system entirely so that you can use them in your own custom programs. Some examples include integrating Pi system data with enterprise resource planning systems, analytics platforms, web portals, and more. Lastly, the Pi AF server also supports high availability features. The Pi AF server is integrated with Microsoft SQL Server, and the high availability portion can be applied to either the Pi AF server application or with built-in features of SQL Server. There's a lot of variation when it comes to making the Pi AF server highly available. Again, we won't go much further with the Pi AF server than this, but for more details, please consult the Pi AF installation and upgrade guide. We've again gone over how to go from a simple Pi system to a more robust architecture, learning about some new Pi system components along the way.